Good afternoon. Thanks for staying with me, late hour. I don't promise you to be entertaining, maybe partially upsetting. Some information about myself. This is my who I was and who I am today. There are some references on my articles on Medium and presentations on SlideShare. If I have to say something, I say it on Twitter. What is important for that talk is my primarily engineering method of combining multiple disciplines together and looking for some non-trivial outcomes in this. And here are the partially topics of today. So today we will connect three points: serverless computing. I will not make any assumptions, and I won't torture you with raising hands. What you know about serverless, I will introduce necessary definitions during the presentation, but it will be very shallow. Don't expect to come out from this as an expert in this area. Python and domain-driven design. And the same, I will not make any assumption that you are familiar with this discipline. I will introduce necessary concepts as we go. So let's start with serverless computing or serverless architecture. It was pioneered by Amazon. Currently, every major cloud vendor is closing the gap. There are no servers to manage, nothing. You're just pure on-demand computing. It's highly available, very available, and it's highly scalable, which is important. In fact, there are two flavors of serverless computing. One is more traditional, AWS Lambda or something similar on Azure or other clouds. But if you look at Fargate announced at reInvent of AWS this year, it's essentially serverless container computing if you are willing to pay for idle. More details could be found on Amazon site. What is important that serverless computing is really tectonic shift in the industry. It's not incremental like proceeding from virtual machines to containers. It's like proceeding from bare metal computers to cloud. And someone in Vardy published a very influential article on this topic. What I would like you to remember from that presentation, if any, is that new platform demands new architectural style and new operational practices. Trying to impose or enforce the new old rules on the new world seldom work well. And what is not less important, we are just at the beginning of this process, transition process. 10 years ago or so, Netflix pioneered cloud-native virtual machine architecture. And it was very well documented and well publicized. And now we understand what does it mean. There are many reports here also on this tell. Some coming a couple of years later, Airbnb probably was the first documented experience of using containers, container native architecture in cloud. We are not aware yet about serverless native architecture, and some experimentation, some exploration of this area is required. We cannot insist yet on what is the right or reasonable or workable way. There are only initial experiments, and tribute to Python, it's a great tool for experimentation, really. And tools apparently have very strong impact on how we think. So that's my contribution to the Python world. It's really a superior tool for experimentation, for exploration of new ideas. I doubt that I would come with the same results, outcomes in other languages. And once I have it in Python, it would be easy to port to other languages. This is an example of Lambda function, serverless computing unit. In Python, it's very simple. Everything which comes before Lambda handler is global definitions, and they are performed once during so-called cold start. Every time an instance of Lambda function is launched, it's a setup process. It takes more time and has an impact on latency. Everything which is in the scope of the function, which has predefined interface of event, which comes as a dictionary and context, is executed at every request. And this is as simple as it is. You could type this code in Amazon console, this or something similar, or develop it on your local machine, zip the file, and upload to the cloud. That's all what you need, nothing more. And there are numbers of performance in the free world. Surprisingly, it's really surprising that .NET 4.2 works extremely well in performance-wise. But if we are talking about open source and free world, JavaScript and Python have very good performance. Unfortunately, Python 3 has some performance degradation, but I still decided to use Python 3. And so I wanted to explore this area and to see what happens. There is a danger. It's so easy to create Lambda function. It's so easy to launch yet another resource or fully managed service on the cloud that we could mess up ourselves beyond any recognition very easily and come up with distributed monolith just created through new fancy tools. So we need some organizing principles. And I decided to pick up my favorite one, which is called Domain-Driven Design. The first book was published around 2000 year by Eric Evans. It's really highly advised to read it. And it's a pretty large set of books discussing this technique. I will pick up only two elements that I found very important for that research activity. Language and boundaries. We will not talk about others, just by time limitations. So one slide about language. Language plays extremely important role in domain-driven design. They call it ubiquitous language. The idea is that domain experts, the business people, have the right picture of the world in their heads. The problem is that the picture is extremely messy because it reflects the world, which is extremely messy and fully connected. It's not separated in modules and interfaces, doesn't have it. We need to automate this, a part of this world, and make it structured. If we don't have common language, we could come up with bug-free software which does something wrong or harmful. And this is a real danger today, because engineering, technically speaking, we could come up with bug-free software if we want to. But we have a big challenge of developing the right software. So that's the first. The second one is boundaries, because one-size-fits model are not practical if possible. And domain-driven design specifically insists on developing models within well-defined contexts and mapping between them upon the need. And the highest level of this breakdown is separation between what they call core domain, what justifies developing software in the first place, completely generic stuff which could be used for developing any software for any domain, and something in between which comes from the same area, but it's not specific enough. It's called supporting subdomain. And we will see an example shortly. And there's a mappings, right, between them. Very often, Python is used as a mapper, as a plumbing software. Many examples of Python and serverless. You will find many examples of kind of plumbing code connecting S3 to recognition service or Kinesis to S3. All kind of plumbing stuff that doesn't do anything useful in terms of domain. My question was, what is involved in developing core domain in Python in serverless environment? So these three points of evaluation criteria: how well domain language is reflected in the code, how well they are separated, and are we using the right model underneath? I picked up as a sample example cargo tracking system. Domain-driven design community used this application to demonstrate principles of domain-driven design. It was first time developed around 2009 in Java. So I pick up it because domain-driven design normally flourishes when domains are complex, when you have many objects, many connections, complex business rules, and you need to cope with them somehow. And questions I wanted to address, what is involved here and what is missing in Python infrastructure, if any. I was very surprised with results, with answers, and I will show you shortly why. I was really surprised. I did not expect what I will get completely. So good education would tell you always start with use case model. Unfortunately, nobody does it, and it's a big problem in industry today. I will start. Okay, so let's look at use case model of cargo tracking system. We have one use case of recording external events when third parties are reporting what happens with the cargo, loaded, unloaded, claimed, passing customs, and internal, like booking cargo, changing, checking its status, and changing direction, and maybe rerouting it back if it's misdirected. You need to start with architectural essential use cases, and it's very important to have software architect on the board. I wear my hat of software architect and say, this first use case of recording the tracking, cargo tracking event is architectural essential because we have high velocity and high volume, many events about coming inside. This interfacing with external systems, and there are a lot of security concerns. I cannot trust data coming in. As this first, just first inch diving in the modern world, we have IoT, so we have a lot of sensors developing, loading, unloading, and moving of cargo. And there are three different protocols to support, plus REST interface to support external UI for third parties, plus REST interface to support internal system. Let's say we will keep events in DynamoDB table, we'll report errors in CloudWatch log system. We will keep historical events in S3 and maybe even for regulatory reasons on Glacier. And it's pretty technically involved stuff, but it's still unclear how much domain logic is there. So let's look at the domain model of event. Event basically has three pointers, on cargo, on voyage. Voyage is a planned schedule of carrier that moves from point to point. And location, it happened at particular location. Apparently, voyage and location belong to what I defined as supporting subdomain. It's not the core, but event itself and cargo, let's say, the core. And a very straightforward implementation would be, okay, let's check cargo ID in cargo table, let's check location in location table, voyage and voyage, and if everything is okay, store it in the database. It's pretty straightforward, simple stuff, and architecturally it would look like something like we have endpoint in API gateway launching Lambda function that will have this access, read access to three tables, write access to one, and ability to log errors in CloudWatch. Could we implement in half an hour? Half an hour, not half an hour, it's implementable. I will not spend your time on reading this Java Python code. It's pretty straightforward. You just check that DynamoDB table has an item, and then you check it three times. There is some domain logic, but it's very hard to find it here. Right? It's blended with a lot of stuff. So the domain language is not reflected properly here. It's blended with many technicalities, not very much relevant. No clear separation between infrastructure and domain. And the question is whether we use the right model here. We all are prone of this techno-fanatical fanatics of any, right, your way or my way. Frankly, if we don't have alternative on the table, it's ideology, it's not engineering. So let's look at an alternative. And the question I ask, whether I used the right model, the right tool, appropriate tool, to model this logic. Maybe I was wrong here. And it's a good question to ask. Apparently, I used wrong, inappropriate tool for that. We are very highly wired, hardly programmed for sequential execution, which is not the case. So if I used UML activity diagram, I would discover that validation, three validations are completely parallel. There's no reason to perform them sequentially. Once I did it, I could check whether there's any problem. If there's a problem, let's report. If no, let's record. That's very simple. And then the next question was how I could implement it. Async IO in Python, JavaScript, any other option. If I were in JavaScript, I promise you, I would jump into concurrent implementation in JavaScript. But because in Python, I needed to install Async IO, I needed to learn it, I didn't know it, and I'm very lazy, I started thinking, maybe there's something else. And I started experimenting with step function in AWS, and I came up with really tiny functions, each one doing only one thing and one thing only. Apparently, there is no code here, or almost no code. Right? I declare repositories in one header file, and just one line, I'm asking whether repository has the item. Now, there is some imagination and chutzpah of implementing infrastructure behind the scene to make it possible, but that's possible, that's all what it has. And then the next question was, could I apply the same simplistic or minimalistic approach to main use case? And let's see it. It's more complicated. Cargo has internary and has a root specification, and they have point to locations. And it's more complicated structure. Again, the separation between core and supportive domain. If I want to get delivery status of cargo, there are three fetches. I need to get specification, I need to get itinerary, and need to get the last event. And there are four calculations. Again, I apply the same logic that what doesn't need to be sequential is not sequential. I could do it in parallel. And so that's what happens here. And again, I could simulate or I could implement it with a step function and a number of very small lambda functions, each one doing one thing. Now my code speaks domain language. Apparently, I have polymorphism over event type. For every event type, there is a very specific check to calculate delivery status. You don't need to understand the technical details. I want to utilize time for something else. But basically, this is very domain-oriented code. It doesn't have any specific of infrastructure, any boilerplate, and even the function signature is not Lambda handler. It's hidden by infrastructure. And then we have very nice architecture when every module is implemented is what Amazon calls cloud formation stack, and they are nicely integrated each to another. Right? It could be called microservices architecture, if you will. Number of missing infrastructural elements. I want to highlight only the last two ones. In order to launch cloud formation stack, you need to create very long, very annoying YAML file. Somebody calls it human readable. I think it's machine code of so-called service application model advertised by Amazon. I dislike this approach, so I introduced a small experimental infrastructure stuff, which I called Mate. I was looking for something which is related to Python. Initially, it was Nahash, but Nahash doesn't sound well, so let's take Mate of Moses, which was converted to Snake upon the need and back, right? And this Mate, it's a small library in Python and a bunch of make-like scripts that generate automatically SAM, generate automatically handler code, so you could fully concentrate on domain logic here. And it's still very experimental, very, very early stage. But now we have nice structure, right? We have core domain on the upper layer, which is concentrated solely on domain. It deals with cargo tracking. It doesn't speak in any other terms. We have some supporting stuff like voyage and location, and Mate nicely lands on the generic subdomain to support this this stuff. And that's my claim that, in fact, software architecture is a context mapping process. You start from use cases, you map it to core domain, and then you map it further to supporting and generic subdomains. You need to be aware, any modularization, any microservice breaking leads to problems of coupling. We don't have time to get into this, but there are some issues, there are some definitions that are across microservices, you need to deal with them somehow. And the obvious question is, it's terribly inefficient. You have a lot of force and backs between step functions and lambda functions. Why would we do it? My first answer is, you never know until you start measuring. You need to measure. And there are some indications that it might work better than we think. The lambda functions are extremely small. They are below lowest available resources on Amazon. So it's very easy to find resources for them. Security checks are very fast. And based on built-in monitoring, I could actually apply machine learning and optimize the internal structure if it needs to be. And the last speculative slide and a half maybe. So what could come after serverless then? Well, I started feeling a little bit monadish. It's not exactly monad computation, but it's close to it. Right? I have a bunch of pure functions that perform domain logic, implement. I have not so pure functions that perform I/O. They fetch something from database or store something in database or send a message or read a message. And I have orchestration layer to implement use case controllers. I report statistics. And I could optimize it. Shall we call it threadless architecture? Early to say, but maybe. That's basically it. And the last slide is a serious invitation to disagree with me. We are at very early stage of emerging serverless architecture. And I fully subscribe to what Dave Snowden said, that consensus is poisonous for innovation, right? If you're familiar with Canavan framework, I argue that serverless architecture is still at early stages of complex adaptive systems, when the only way to deal with it will be probe, sense, respond. We need just to run safe to fail experiments to see what happens, learn from mistakes. I was changing the code and presentation till the last moment, because every time I found something else and something I was not satisfied with. So please disagree with me. And thank you very much. Any questions, if you have time? Okay, the question was, if you don't know how to scale the system, what will happen? That's exactly the point, that it's not my business. Amazon scales it. And Amazon, believe me, is very good in scaling, right? They know how to run this stuff. And the whole point of serverless is that I cannot hide behind virtual machines, routers, and firewalls, and not to develop what I'm paid for business software, right? I don't have this excuse anymore. I need to deal with real stuff. And I could say scaling, it used to be a problem for web scale systems 10 years ago. It's not anymore. Web scale architecture is not differentiator anymore. Cloud vendors do this job for you. And that's what's going to happen. How exactly, we still don't know, maybe, right? But that's what's going to happen. Okay, thank you very much.